Today, I would like to introduce our speaker. We have Michael Rethwisch. He's the farm advisor in crop production and entomology with the University of California Cooperative Extension in Riverside County. And today, he's going to be speaking on alfalfa insects and their management in California. So now I would like to pass this over to Michael. And Michael, you can go ahead and share your slides.
Good afternoon, everyone. As was said, today I have been tasked with the challenging topic of alfalfa insect pests and their management in California. If we think about California, we have alfalfa that grows from Oregon all the way down to Arizona and Mexico, from basically sea level to the intermountain areas. So we have a wide diversity of cropping situations and environments for alfalfa. So it's not surprising at all that the different parts of the state have different insect pests or the same pests at different times of the year. If we look at the low desert, we're just pretty much getting to the point of finishing up our alfalfa weevil season. There's blue alfalfa aphids and pea aphids out there. Cowpea aphids are kind of disappearing. And in the summer, we're going to see various caterpillars and leaf hoppers, three-cornered alfalfa hoppers. The San Joaquin Valley, well, it's a little bit different, being a little bit cooler. The weevils are going to hang on till probably almost July. Blue alfalfa aphids are there, pea aphids. You've got cowpea aphids from January, and then from October into basically May, spotted alfalfa aphid in July, August, and September. And various caterpillars and leaf hoppers in the summer months. But if we look at the intermountain areas, we see that things are very much condensed because of the freezes and the temperatures and the growing season. And really, we have basically things there from March into September and a little bit sometimes into October. So that's kind of where things are. It depends upon where you are, what you're going to see, and what you're going to see at various times of the year. So if we think about alfalfa weevils, that has a what we call a complete life cycle. We have the summer, the weevils themselves actually survive in the summertime as adults. In the fall or the spring, depends upon what strain that you have, they come out of summer estivation and then they lay their eggs. And then the larva, these eggs hatch. We have alfalfa weevil larvae coming out. And you can see, hopefully, on your screen a picture of the alfalfa there. And you can see it kind of looks really lacy from the feeding of the alfalfa weevil larvae. This obviously reduces the quality and also reduces the yield. So, in the United States, we have three different strains of alfalfa weevil. We have the Egyptian and the Eastern, and the Eastern is basically found east of the Rockies. In the Southwest, we here and in Southern California, we have the Egyptian. And then in the Intermountain states, we have the Western strain. And the Western strain is actually infected with a bacteria called Wolbachia, which can affect some of the reproductive aspects, and also changes the behavior slightly as well. So if we look at this, the Eastern and the Egyptian strains, they become active earlier in the year, and they can actually lay eggs in stems in the fall. And there are some reports of enhanced abilities of these strains to be able to encapsulate eggs of the wasp called Bathyplectes, which will attack and lay eggs in the larvae. But if we look at where we are with the Western, well, the Western strain becomes active later in the year. So it's not even known to lay eggs in the fall. It doesn't lay eggs until after wintertime or after the winter. And when we look at these things where they're both together in the same areas, we're seeing peaks of these things with the Western being 1 to 3 weeks later in the year than we have with the Eastern strain. Very interesting dynamics. And when you have both strains in the same places, you can have some interesting things happening. So if we look at what's happening with alfalfa weevils and insecticide control in the Western United States. Well, in 1904, alfalfa weevils were found for the first time in the US in Utah, and these were Western strain. About 35 years later, in 39, alfalfa weevils are found at Yuma, Arizona, and these were Egyptian strain. And we're seeing damage across basically all the Western states since then. If we think about this, I believe this is in 1946, I believe, we had these chlorinated hydrocarbon insecticides started being applied for alfalfa weevils. And at that time, that was products like dieldrin and heptachlor. So they started in 46. But by 1962, there was a report that came out of Utah that said 4 ounces of either heptachlor or dieldrin applied in early spring failed to control the weevil larvae's adults and larvae already back in 61 and 62 after just 15 years on the market. And as in the next several years after that, there were many reports of insecticide resistance across the US to these insecticides, as well as basically other insecticides in this class, which meant they were having cross resistance to the entire class of insecticides. I believe it's 69 here, we know that furadan or carbofuran became available for usage on alfalfa, and it provided excellent control of both alfalfa aphids and weevils, widely adapted because it was able to take care of both pests at the same time, and people liked it and they used it a lot. But in 2009, furadan usage on alfalfa was canceled. And during this time, there were no reports of resistance to alfalfa weevils, even though this insecticide had been on the market for 40 years. So that was a really nice thing, no resistance, but we no longer have that product available. So where are we? What are we using now since furadan has been taken off the market? We're basically seeing in the past now about three different classes of insecticides that are being used. One class are the pyrethroid insecticides, where we have things like Bathroid and Mustang Max and Warrior 2, and the generics now come with these active ingredients. So we have several pyrethroids out there. We have the organophosphates, dimethoate and chlorpyrifos were used quite a bit. However, we know that chlorpyrifos now, which is Lorsban, was taken off the market, but I understand in a couple of states it's being allowed back in. But we've already heard some reports there across the Western United States about some resistance potentially to Lorsban as well. And the other class we have out there are the endoxicarbs, and that's the active ingredient in Steward. So where do we stand now with control of alfalfa weevil in the Western U.S.? Well, here's what's happening. We have resistance developing. In 2015 in Northern California, close to the Oregon border, they were having failures with control of both Bathroid and Warrior 2 controlling alfalfa weevils. And as you can see on this chart, hopefully, in their organic fields, they're still getting 92% control, but where they had been applying these products year after year after year, they were down to 15% control at the best. Not a good picture. That was for Western strain. Now, in 2018 here where I'm located, we've had a field failure controlling alfalfa weevils, which is the Egyptian strain, here with Lambda Cy Halothrin or Warrior 2. And when we looked at the bioassays of this from the labs, we showed very high resistance levels as well. And it was when we did a sampling across the area in the valley here, you can see what kind of control we're getting over there on that far right where we had that field failure. We had 8.3% in a lab bioassay in fields that got almost annual applications. We're still above 25%, but less than 30% control in the bioassays. In fields that got something every 1 year, or I mean every other year, or every third year, we're still almost 60% control. And in some of the organic fields we had, we were still at 93.3% control. So definitely a correlation here that could be drawn with the amount of exposure in the past in these field areas to the pyrethroid insecticides. So to make things even worse, We tested other pyrethroid insecticides, including active ingredients that weren't even on the alfalfa market yet. We found we had cross resistance not only to one or two pyrethroid insecticides, but basically the entire class. So we have cross resistance to basically all pyrethroid insecticides in some of these locations. What was also interesting to us is that we were seeing mixing of the weevil populations. Fields that were organic and basically had almost 100% control in 1 year. The next year, the weevil populations taken from those fields only getting about 50 to 70% control. So we're seeing mixing of populations in the off-site situations because the weevils are going from multiple fields are congregating in these overwintering locations and mating, and then they're going back to different fields the next. The good news on this is that our resistance is highly localized, as the weevils by themselves do not move very far. If we get more than a half mile, I'm surprised. Usually it's just the next field over. But these things can travel on equipment, on hay. And we do know these things happen because we do know there's a spread of certain things across the United States. So just because it's in your field doesn't mean you don't have it, or then your neighbor may not have it, or vice versa. So it's a site by site situation. So where are we at now with controlling alfalfa weevils? Well, we can do nothing and take the losses, which is not necessarily what people want to see, but some people do this. In certain situations here in Southern California, we are able to sheep off the fields, which means they bring the sheep in from usually in February, maybe January, and they graze the entire area off. So they remove the stems, and that removes the host area for the weevils, and they just sheep it off. And some people are happy about that. The trouble is there's not enough sheep to go around. And when the fields get wet, there's sometimes some hoof damage. And sometimes we're going to see some damage maybe to the crowns as well. Some people will try to do an early harvest and or they'll try to cut it and or to time the alfalfa so the stems are not quite big enough for the weevils to lay eggs. But if you're just one thing we've seen in our winter weather here, unlike other parts of the country, are when we're cutting here in January or early February, it takes a long time to dry because our drying conditions are not conducive to rapid curing, and we still get a lot of weevil damage under the windrows or even in the windrows because it's still very soft and moist and the weevils still continue to chew away. So the other option that we have after all this is to use insecticides. And so we're going to talk about that just a bit here because what are our options now? Well, let's talk about that. If we look at what we are for thresholds in California to determine when we should be spraying, it does make a bit of a difference on the technique that we use. In the past, and what it was have California's been with using for quite a few years now in this state, it has been an economic threshold of 20 larvae per 180-degree sweep. But here in Southern California, we don't necessarily use that because that threshold was developed using flat planted alfalfa. Here in the desert, especially on our heavy soils, we see a lot of bed planted alfalfa. And so there's differences there. And the sweeping technique is different because 180 degree sweep on bedded alfalfa is tough on the elbows and the shoulders. And the same amount of area that sampled is not the same as 180 degree sweep on flat planted alfalfa. So when we've done some comparisons here, we're finding when we use a pendulum sweep or a figure eight sweep on the alfalfa, on bedded alfalfa, we were able to come up with some solid comparisons to to 180 degree sweep. And we're basically seeing we're getting about 3.8 to one, roughly 4 to 1 more weevils that way than just 180. So when we divide that 20 by 4, we get basically five weevils per sweep, and we seem to be very good at using that as a threshold, whether it be embedded or flat-platted alfalfa. The reason we pick up more is that these sweeps are deeper rather than just the stem tips. And because of that, we're likely to collect smaller larvae, which are also easier to kill than the larger larvae. We also see some of the beneficial insects that way too, because they're deeper in the canopy. So if we look at our trials from the last 5, 6 years, and look at our insecticide ratings for areas like this that have pyrethroid resistance, I want to draw your attention to the things that have either pink or kind of a yellow gold situation there as far as the scores go. And if we look at that, we really don't see much of anything at all that's getting above 80% control. The one product that we have out there that's giving us basically 90% control or better is Steward. And we're seeing good control, especially at 6 and 6.7 ounces per acre. Even 4 ounces per acre are doing a pretty good job. The only other thing we see out there that we've tested over the years and has gotten above 80% reduction has been a combination of 7XLR plus with the com when added to Warrior 2. However, I cannot necessarily recommend that as a product to be combination to be used because we see a lot of foliage burn, and the level of damage is not going to be acceptable for commercial purposes. So basically, that leaves us with one product in that we can use, which is Steward, that's going to be effective in these situations. And that's kind of disconcerting in a way because there's nothing really on the near horizon that's going to be there in the next couple of years. But we'll see. The question is now, will resistance develop to indoxacarb or Steward? We don't know. And obviously, if we can rotate insecticide classes, that reduces our insecticide risk. And we don't know if this is going to be like Furadan and resistance does not develop, or if it's going to be like some of the other classes. I guess we'll find out in the next several years. I did want to bring up a couple things as well. Here's some things you may or may not know about alfalfa weevils. How long do alfalfa weevils live? Well, they've been found to live up to 3 years in outdoor conditions. So this is just not a one and done. Sometimes they're out there for several years. Usually, one and a half to two is more like it, but they have been found to live at least for 3 years. And the other question that comes up from time to time is, do weevils have more than one generation per year? And the answer on this one is that yes, a partial second generation has been noted in some years. And this is usually, they find them usually in June. And these are usually in locations that had early freezes or cold temperatures early in the fall, because that brought the weevils out of estivation. And the oviposition begins much earlier than normal, which allowed them to mature and to lay eggs there back a little bit later in May or in June. If we look at some numbers here from the San Joaquin Valley in 2018, we can see March, April that year where they had some peaks. And then they had a pretty substantial second peak in some of these fields in late June. So that brings us to the question of, why just two generations? Why not multiple generations all year round? Why is this just kind of a certain time of the year? Well, the reason for that is that it takes about 60 days after the new adult female has started her life as an adult before her ovaries are functional. Okay. And then we also see that oviposition stops on the first day of summer when there's a change to shorter day length. However, this does not seem to apply to fall oviposition. So we're not sure exactly why there is a difference that way. Most places in the United States are only going to have one generation, just kind of a narrow band of, across northern Arizona, a little bit here north of us, and then in the San Joaquin Valley and a few other places that latitude and temperature combination we're going to see that second generation. Now, there are some beneficials out there. There are some parasitic wasps that such as the bathyplectes here on the left, which we can identify by that distinctive yellow underside there on the abdomen. But it doesn't really kill the weevils until they have been done feeding. And there is a ladybird beetle, the seven-spotted ladybird beetle, which will feed on weevil larvae. Now, this is the seven spot. The typical convergent lady beetle, which is smaller, is not known to feed on weevil larvae. So, unfortunately, for this part of the country, weevils are often accompanied by aphid infestations. So, what do we know about aphids in alfalfa? And what happens? We got both of these things happening at the same time. Well, one of the things we know that we've learned over the years that dealing with aphids is much more complex than it is dealing with alfalfa weevils. This is because alfalfa weevil larvae are feeding on that most tender growth, usually near that tip. Thus, they're more exposed to foliar applied insecticides. They have a pretty long life cycle, basically only one generation per year. And biological control is supplemental or secondary, and it really doesn't do much for control for most of us in the West, but it does help. So if we look at where we are with aphids in comparison, well, here in California, we can have multiple aphid species present at the same time. We know that there's multiple generations occurring during an alfalfa cutting cycle, and these life cycles are very, very short. We know that winged aphids can migrate into a field in fairly high numbers, and they can cause a lot of damage in a hurry. And we also know that some aphid species inject toxins into the alfalfa plants as they feed, which is why some of that damage happens very quickly. And not only do the aphids feed on stem terminals, but also in the crowns, sometimes the stems, and or the leaf undersides, depending upon the species. So there are interactions between alfalfa stem height and alfalfa insecticide efficacy as well. And we also know that aphids differ in their response to insecticides by species. Now, what happens in California is that we know that some aphid species can be greatly controlled, reduced by predators and parasitoids. These predators and parasitoids can also be affected by certain insecticides. But there is also geographic differences where we have the parasitoids active. So let's take a look at where we are right now. This is what we're seeing some places here in where I'm at right now. We've got aphids there, and a lot of blue alfalfa aphids on the stem. And the big picture on the right here is what a grower sent to me about 2 days ago saying, we've got lots of aphids out here. What should we use? What should we do? And as you can see, there are some ladybird larvae in there as well, which is a good sign. But right now, the aphids have a big head start. Okay. On your screen, you should see four of the typical alfalfa aphids we have out there. And as you can see, these are basically arranged by size. So we have four aphids out there. Our biggest one on the left is the pea aphid. And of these four aphids, it is the one that does not inject a toxin. But the blue alfalfa aphid does, and it's not quite as big as the pea aphid. The cowpea aphid does. And the other one that we have is the spotted alfalfa aphid, and it also injects a toxin. So three out of these four inject a toxin and can stunt the plant growth and cause some problems. Now, there is another alfalfa aphid out there that I think perhaps we overlook quite a bit. And this is actually what we call the real alfalfa aphid, or basically known alfalfa aphid. It's a macrocyphon. It's not in the same genus as the others. This was already reported to be a pest of Western alfalfa back in 1914. It looks very, very much like the pea aphid. And if we look at this, we see on the alfalfa aphid, we have kind of a band there at the end of the first antennal segment. You can see that with the arrow. And then after that point in time, there may be a second one here. And then we get nice and dark from here on out. So the other thing is the cornicles. And we see, and their high magnification, we see kind of this, it gets a little bit darker on that second half. And the thing that really helps you identify whether you have alfalfa aphid or pea aphid is the very tip out here under magnification. It has 4 to 5 rows of reticulation. And if we look at this, here on the left is what we have, macrocyphon, which is the alfalfa aphid. And you can see that reticulation there at the end of the cornicle. If we look at the surface of the siphon, which is the genus for pea aphid and blue alfalfa aphid, we can see that that is, it's not there. But it's really hard to see it. It takes good magnification. And you can see this is what we're seeing right now with some of our large green aphids. It seems like the alfalfa aphid, the true alfalfa aphid, does very well at temperatures at 50 and below. So we're wondering if what we're seeing right now, because it's been very odd to see this many large green aphids at this time of year or even a month ago. We're suspicious, but it has not yet been verified that we're dealing with the true alfalfa aphid this year in our local alfalfa. One nice thing about that is that they're both fairly large, but neither species, the pea aphid or the alfalfa aphid, is known to inject a toxin. So that's a good thing, because it's usually the aphids that are injecting the toxins that are causing the biggest problems. And for us locally, that is the blue alfalfa aphid, not only here, but in Utah. We're seeing it in Arizona. It is probably a big, big pest of alfalfa. And we can tell the two aphids apart. On your screen here on the left is the blue alfalfa aphid, and the antennas get gradually darker from the base to the tips. If you look at the pea aphid, we see that, it's good. We have kind of should have 3 to 4 rows of bands sometimes on those antenna segments. So it's easy to tell them apart that way. And we're seeing the past 2 decades, what we were seeing, and especially the 2010s, we were seeing some extremely high numbers of blue alfalfa aphids out here. And we can see that we're going a couple of years, we went over 500 per sweep. This is kind of interesting, because in Australia, we do know that they are seeing multiple biotypes now of blue alfalfa aphid. And some of these are more produce more offspring faster. They have more virulent toxins, and they're also developing insecticide resistance. So far, we don't know what we have here. We have not been seeing that, but we've been using different insecticides here than they have been in Australia for that. So as we said, the blue alfalfa aphid for us, it injects a toxin while it feeds. Obviously, we can get crop loss. And on small plants, we can even see some injury and death that way as well. So sometimes you get that initial infestation, and we've seen this in California all the way up into Washington. We'll just see this kind of brownish circle where that first couple aphids have landed, and they start giving birth to new aphids, and it just kind of expands from that way. But here what we'll see a lot of times are big, big flights of blue alfalfa aphids coming from the south. And we can do a lot of damage in a hurry. It's a couple of years ago, we were picking about 275 aphids per square foot over a 2-day period, about right at this time of year. So for us, they're flying in right now. And you look real closely, you can see this kind of gray looking alfalfa. This is with the damage that was done. It's shorter, it's stunted, it's off color. And that was done pretty much just by the adult aphids flying in a 7-day period. So it can do some pretty big damage for us real quickly here when they fly in. We're suspicious that these larger winged aphids are feeding more because they're bigger, they're injecting more toxin. And in our plots, we can see some sizable differences sometimes. And when we look at these kind of things and with a drone and look at the stress on the plants, in this particular field, the darker the blue, the better control we've had, the plants are greener, at least with the what they're being picked up here, where it's orange, it's really, really heavily fed upon and stunted by the alfalfa. We got various levels of blue and orange out here, and certain compounds did very, very well. You can see what some of these entries look like. It's not really fantastic. So the bottom line is, what did we see? Well, if we look at this, we have Belief, we have Mustang Max, we have the Untreateds. We saw things like Warrior give us really kind of short alfalfa, but very, very lots of leaves because it was stunted by the feeding. We things like Transform and Savanto and Indigo gave us really nice tall plants, and they gave us more yield. So when we talk about the yield, so what do we see? Well, in this case, in these situations, it's not unusual for us to see over a half a ton yield decrease from lack of control of blue alfalfa aphids. So on our far left, this is after 28 days of exposure. Our Savanto Prime at 14 looked pretty good, followed by a couple of rates of Transform, but Transform is not registered in California, although it is everywhere else. Here we have the Safina in the green bar and a couple more rates in purple here of the Savanto. And then we have a couple of things that are not registered. And you can see over here on the far right, the white bar is the Untreated. Here's Warrior and here's Mustang Max. So here's our pyrethroids. Didn't give us much more yield than the Untreated because even though we knocked the aphids down real quickly, the pyrethroids also killed off a lot of the beneficial insects, especially these large ladybirds, beetles, and larvae, which are helping to keep them in check. So that's what we saw there. But I think most of us in alfalfa realize there's a trade-off between yield and quality. And our highest quality came from the Mustang, the Warrior, and the Untreated because it was stunted. And therefore we had less stem, therefore a higher leaf to stem ratio. And so we kind of a trade-off for yield versus quality. But this really helped the local growers to understand why, when they treated with certain chemistries to control aphids, all of a sudden their hay was not testing as well as they had hoped. And it became very clear that in the past, maybe some of the aphid damage was helping their quality at the expense of yields. So if we look at this, from blue alfalfa aphid in the low desert, it's not unusual to see damages of 1,000 pounds or more if it's not treated. You go in between, some of the areas such as the San Joaquin Valley, we're seeing a newly planted hay, 1,200 pounds an acre. It might be even greater if the aphids are arriving earlier in that growth cycle. And the other thing we'll see sometimes in the inner mountains, some really severe situations. We're hearing some spring losses of over a ton per acre due to blue alfalfa aphid. So at least in the desert here, we're, just half a ton, but other places could be a lot worse. And we know in states like Utah, it gets hit really hard. Now, one of the things that we have to remember is that most of our insecticides that we use now for aphid control, such as Transform and Belief and Safina and Savanto Prime, is that they are not fully systemic, but they're just acropedally systemic. And acropedally systemic means they only move up in the plant, they don't go down to the base. Dimethoate, furadan, they were fully systemic, but these new ones don't go down, they just go up. But that generally means we're not gonna see really quick control, and usually our control looks better at 10 days versus 3 days. So for aphids, we may have to adapt some concepts from fungicides, where they talk about some products being preventative and others being curative. So for us, we're looking at now using these slower acting insecticides such as Belief and Safina. They probably should be considered more preventative, need to be applied earlier in the growth cycles or to shorter alfalfa when fewer aphids are present, to kind of negate the alfalfa aphid feeding. But in California, our only fast-acting one we have that's effective against blue alfalfa aphid is Savanto Prime, and that would give us a much wider range of application windows. So there's lots of things that can affect this. We're we're watching the weather. We know our blue alfalfa aphids have been affected here in our area quite a bit by the rains and snows in other parts of California, and we're seeing a change. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens down the road here. Some people ask about biological controls. We know that there are parasitic wasps that will attack these things. A female wasp lays an egg. The wasp develops inside the aphid. It kills the aphid. It comes out, and then you have a dead aphid and one wasp that's alive. And it takes about 14 days for this to happen. So that's good, but it's still only one aphid that's killed for each wasp. And so it's kind of a slow thing. The thing we also see is that different aphids have different wasps attack them. And for cowpea aphids, we have a couple different genera of wasps that will attack it. But for locally here in the low desert, because of so hot in the summer, we have no parasitic wasps here that are here on a yearly basis that will attack pea aphid or blue alfalfa aphid. So for us, we're stuck with insecticide control or maybe some seven spotted lady beetles to help us get through. People have asked about aphid pre-production. Well, with blue alfalfa aphids, we'll see that they start giving birth at about a week old. And then they give birth basically to 5 aphids per day for about a week. So it's not unusual for one aphid to have given birth to basically 25 to 30 aphids within a 2-week period. But it's interesting to note when they're parasitized, they still continue to reproduce. It's just they stop at about 10 days of age, but there's still a substantial reduction there. But it's not like the ladybird beetles that will eat these things, and they can eat quite a few aphids. Now, in the picture here on the right, we've got 2 different species. We've got the smaller one is the convergent lady beetle, and then we have the larger one, which is the 7-spotted lady beetle. And we know that 7-spot, well, it'll eat a lot more. It eats like basically twice as many aphids, and it can also feed on weevil larvae from time to time. And the convergent, it used to be, we'd see this quite a bit, but it doesn't like cold temperature. I mean, it does not like warm temperature. It prefers cool. So these things will start disappearing for us when we get in February and March. So we've also done some work on seedling alfalfa, because obviously our thresholds change there quite a bit. We have basically big pests there being thrips and spot alfalfa aphids and cowpea aphids. And again, like we said before, the spot alfalfa aphid does feed an injected toxin, but unlike the other aphids, this aphid species feeds primarily on the undersides of leaves. So the others will feed on the stems and tips and down below, but this one's going to be found primarily on the undersides of leaves. And what we'll see sometimes on our fall planted alfalfa, we'll see almost a soil discoloration around the plant or under the plant because of the honeydew being deposited. And that obviously means these things are potentially being killed due to their feeding. So we can also have thrips out there, which can cause some strange looking plants. Here's the adult. And you can see a sweep net here, what we're picking up as far as the larvae go. And we can see that the thrips are causing some problems on just making it kind of look really, really puckered leaves. And the reason for this is that thrips have very unique mouth parts, and then they're scraping with one side and they're sucking it off. And so all other insects have chewing or piercing, sucking mouth parts, but the thrips, they're very unique. So that's why we see some scarring and some whiting. And we've been getting reports the last couple of years out of Idaho and Colorado about Western flower thrips being a big problem in the summertime in alfalfa, especially when the adjacent grain crops are being harvested and you have these in-flights of thrips coming in. But for us, we also know this is a very beneficial insect because it's the main predator of 2-spotted spider mites. So we've talked about cowpea aphids a little bit. We know that These things also inject a toxin. We know it's usually more problematic in older stands. Sometimes they're young stands as well. Again, we can see stunting and death of the stems. You can see these stems turning white, curling over. This is a very powerful toxin, and it can cause some problems here. So we did a study looking at seedling alfalfa. We sprayed it. We came in. We knocked the insects off of it into kind of a backboard, moved those insects down. We counted them and to see what's happening. And what were our results? Well, in this case, we got over on the far right, you can see the untreated. The pink bars are the cowpea aphids. The gold bars there are spot alfalfa aphids, and the red bars are western flower thrips. And there's one product that really stood out for us in that was fast acting, real quickly in 3 days, and kind of rescued the crops in the situation. And this was dimethoate. And you can see it did a good job on all three pests. We saw some other things have some activity. The transformed Savanto was going okay, but just was not quite as quick or as fast as the dimethoate at this point in time. And as we know, it's very effective against cowpea aphids, but we want to keep this available in California, if only for the purpose of seedling alfalfa, because there's annual limitations on how much Savanto Prime and Safina we can use. And sometimes we're using quite a bit for that for aphids, let alone our summer insects. I can tell you, however, dimethoate is not the product of choice for blue alfalfa aphids. So we've looked at some things. We're going to just skip through this in the interest of time. Dimethoate looked pretty good, again, in this situation as well. But as we can say here, it did not look good at all against blue alfalfa aphids. And I would be remiss if we didn't talk about spider mites. And I know our time is getting short here. We've had some spider mite problems the last couple of years with the weather changes. It's been really interesting. The deserts get dried up and the mites start blowing in, and we saw lots of damage. In 2023, we had some problems where basically the bottom two-thirds of some of these stems were no longer with leaves. They just defoliated them. Not very good at all. We want to touch a little bit on caterpillar pests. I know we've got beet armyworms, granulate cutworms, and alfalfa caterpillars here. Well, right now we're seeing variegated cutworms' eggs. We have some other things out there as well. Like I said, we are seeing variegated cutworm eggs out there right now. They're kind of late. You can see they're kind of white. They're kind of interesting look, kind of a sculptured type radiating out. And then we have the larvae. And then we have the larger larvae, which you can identify by that series of yellowish dots along the middle of the back there. But in addition to that, we have granulate cutworms here, beet armyworms, alfalfa caterpillars, and we have two new pests for U.S., continental U.S., which is dot-lined angle and alfalfa leaf tire. But one thing I want to bring to all of you is that we have biological controls out there that work at night, but we don't see them because we're not out there at night. And we're seeing out there right now a lot of these caterpillar hunter beetles, and these things love to eat cutworms and other caterpillars. And these things will hide during the day, and they will feed at night, and they will be out there, for several months because they'll live that long. And they do climb the foliage, and they do a great job of eating a lot of caterpillars, but certain insecticides can wipe them out. And just to go back to talk about this new pest, this is what they call the alfalfa leaf tire. It's basically new to the continental U.S., but it's been as far as alfalfa goes. And we can identify it by that sclerotized area there right behind the head. And what some people call it the taco caterpillar, because it ties some leaves together and kind of looks like a taco in a way to some people. But it actually feeds within those tied leaves. And when it comes out of it, it kind of looks like we have armyworm damage, but it's alfalfa leaf tire. Controlling these things are kind of difficult, is challenging. They're somewhat protected from a lot of these insecticides. And we can see prior to finding it here in 2021, Florida, the Gulf Coast, and one spot in San Diego, but it was known from Hawaii. So we saw it here right along the Mexican border. One year, the next year, it expanded by about 200 miles in 2022. And we also have picked up a few larvae already this year. And just for the people that have a couple quick questions here, I wanted to bring this picture to you about blister beetles. Now, blister beetles themselves are not really a big problem in alfalfa, but they are a problem if they're crushed in the hay. And I want everyone to realize that there's an association between blister beetles and grasshopper eggs, because grasshopper eggs are what the blister beetle larvae feed on. That's their food sources. So if you have lots of grasshoppers, it's going to be very conducive for blister beetle perhaps that next year. So kind of to wrap up here, California alfalfa is subject to a lot of different pests, weevils and aphids and things like that, lots of different situations. But our warm season situations here are highly conducive to insect survival and abundance. And these insects can cause some serious economic losses. And we're really watching very closely our insecticide resistance aspect, because California has fewer registered products to use for rotational purposes than adjacent states. And the other thing that's happening now, we've found some new insect pests. So with that, I don't know if we've got time for questions, but if we are, I'll see what we can do here.
Thank you so much. At this point, we only have one question, so I'll just ask really quickly. And I think this came in during the aphid part. Did you test lacewings for beneficial insect control?
The question is, do we test lacewings for insect control? And when we do our samples out there, we don't necessarily spray or put out lacewings by themselves. We'll find them occasionally in alfalfa, but not nearly as high of numbers as other beneficial insects. Other lacewings tend to be, they're obviously the larval stages are known as aphid lions. So they will eat quite a few aphids. But the question is alfalfa a good enough substrate for them to be laying their eggs upon and to survive? But we just don't see a lot of lacewings in our local alfalfa, not compared to other crops.
I really do appreciate you coming on here and presenting today.
You're welcome. Thank you for the opportunity, Cheryl.